guest is known as the voice of racing. Johnny Tapp is a legendary race caller. Have a listen.
Bay Foyle is only plugging. Stella Frost now getting clear, but Mount Eden is going to win the Miracle Mile by a big space. A champion, a freak, and a horse in a million. Mount Eden has won by 5 or 6 lengths.
Thank you. Good to be here. You picked a nice recent replay there.
Yeah, that's
right. 1971.
You remember that race?
That was the Miracle Mile at the dear old Harold Park.
Harold Park,
track,
that's
which
right.
Is long
no
gone.
Longer. I know, such a
And that race. Horse, Mount Eden, was a West Aussie. And I've said this before, and I'll stick with it. That was the greatest individual performance I have ever seen by a horse of either breed, standard bred or thoroughbred.
Really?
He did the impossible that night.
But trots, racing, the whole lot, anything.
Yep. The greatest single performance of any horse I saw in 50 years at the races.
Wow. Goodness.
Amazing.
God.
Mount
That's a
Eden.
Big call, John.
And you can still remember it because that was, what, more than 50,000 race calls ago for you.
Yeah, that's right,
it?
Joe. Yeah.
I mean, that's extraordinary to call that many.
He just did the impossible that night. He galloped in the score up behind the mobile starting gate and he missed the start by 50 metres against the best horses available in the Southern Hemisphere in that era. He caught them by the time they got to the bell lap and had the hide to race away and beat them by, imperially speaking, 17 yards.
You can tell why you've had so much success, Johnny, because you're so passionate about racing and, you know, you speak so beautifully about it. Can you tell us how this passion for racing first began for you?
Age 10.
Mm. 10!
Sydney suburb of Cogra. I wanted to be a race caller, having been completely enchanted by the voice of a man called Ken Howard on Sydney radio, the most dynamic, entertaining, showman-type race caller we've ever heard in this country. Mm. By 10, I wanted to emulate Ken.
Aww. How do you go about
and
doing that?
And didn't you have that amazing story that I loved of when you had the paddle pop sticks?
Yeah.
And you used to call the paddle pop sticks,
they
didn't
were
you?
My first horses.
So tell us about
paddle pop sticks. They were laying all over the streets in that era. So I would collect them, paint them in the colours pertaining to the well-known racehorses of that era, the 1950s.
Wow.
Grade them accordingly. I'd have a maiden handicap, a novice handicap, a weight for age race, a golden slipper or whatever. Throw them into a stormwater channel where there was a rapidly flowing current of water and I'd walk for miles through that channel calling these imaginary races with the paddle pop sticks.
Mm. That and is just extraordinary.
People who lived along that channel said, "Here's that mad kid again."
But what was that? Why did you love it so much? What was it that made you think, this is not only going to be my profession but my passion and my life?
Ken Howard.
Yeah.
He made it sound so darn good. He made the hair on the back of your neck stand up. Aww. And he could call a Gosford maiden with the same verve and the same passion as a Melbourne Cup.
Wow.
He whetted my appetite irretrievably. Mm. I had to be a race caller.
Mm. Now, Johnny, did you ever say the wrong horse's name?
Oh, several times.
Not the one that won, though.
It happened to me maybe 4 times over a long period of years.
Out of 50,000, that's not bad.
I guess so, but it was disappointing on the day. You know, I'd love to have another crack at those 4 races. But mistaken identity.
Yeah.
For some reason, I was convinced horse A was horse B, for whatever the reason. And it's like being on a bus. You can't get off until it stops. You know, you're stuck with it unless you have somebody standing beside you in the broadcast box who can dig you in the ribs, point to the race book.
Yeah.
But even then, it's hard to recover.
That's right, because you're already there.
All the excitement is about Winx at the moment. You know, she's being hailed a legendary horse. Is there a particular horse that you would have loved to call or in a race or that you have called in a race over the years that was just a really dramatic horse to...
I loved Kingston Town.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
whose record Winks equaled last Saturday by winning three consecutive Cox Plates. Every time I go to Melbourne and I've got a spare half day, you know where I go?
I'm guessing
the museum to visit Farah.
Did you ever call Farah?
Oh, no, no. Are you kidding?
Don't listen to her.
I'm blaming the Brady brain. I'm so sorry.
Farah died the year the Harbour Bridge was up.
You can tell I'm into race.
I'd love to interview you one day.
That's right. Speaking of, though, do you think, we were talking about Farlap just the other day, do you think Winks is the best ever? Do you think that Winks has surpassed Farlap and even Black Caviar as the greatest racehorse ever?
Joe, it is almost impossible to compare horses of different eras, particularly such far apart eras as the 30s and the 2000s. I mean, the tracks are better today.
Yeah.
Training methods are different. There are a million and one advantages the modern day racehorse have that Farlap didn't have. Farlap did it on hard feed and hard work. And talent.
That's exactly right. I'm reminded of when they asked Donald Bradman once if he thought that Sachin Tendulkar was as good as him, and Donald Bradman said, "Oh, you know what? I think he's actually probably even better than me. But mind you, I am 92." It's like that, isn't it?
He loved Tendulkar, and he always regarded Tendulkar as having style as close to his that he'd ever seen.
That's right.
Now, Johnny, there's part of racing, of course, which is the punting. I'm not sure if you're a punter as well as a racer.
No, never have been.
See, isn't that interesting? But I'm sure you've got some tips. I'm not a better either, but I think everyone has a punt on the Melbourne Cup, or most of us. Any tips?
Well, Susie, I should preface my selection by telling you that the last Melbourne Cup winner I tipped was Dal Ray in 1952. So I would take this with a grain of salt because it's the toughest race in Australia to try and sort out.
Yeah.
But I do like this English horse, Marmello.
Oh,
He's
I'll
a five-year-old stallion.
Marmello.
He won a race in France in August called the Prix de Kergoulet, which has been a very good guide to the Melbourne Cup.
Right.
It's over 3,000 metres. He ran in the Caulfield Cup 2 weeks ago and was working to the line like a two-miler, if ever you've seen one. Winx's jockey, by the way.
Oh, there you go.
Ride Marmello, Hugh
Bowman.
Sure thing. There you go. You heard it here first. Get on
He's
it.
Got his, I got to tell you about my underpants.
Oh, you've got lucky underpants.
That's the main reason I'm here.
Yes, please.
Hello. Please. That just took a turn for the better.
You bet.
I have to ask, when you wear underpants, are they jockeys?
Yes, of course.
Sorry,
Mate, you bet have been aware for a long time that there is nobody on earth more superstitious than a punter.
Yeah.
I've known many of them who wouldn't go to the races without their lucky tie, lucky socks, lucky suit, whatever. So you bet decided to capitalise on this fact and manufacture 1,000 pairs of black and lime green underpants in the hope that punters would buy them online, $10 a pair.
That's a good price.
And
we're going to see them in just a moment, so I would
feel lucky going to the races. Because every dollar that these generate goes to the National Jockeys Trust to aid the families of those jockeys who've lost their lives.
Because it is a very dangerous sport, isn't it?
Oh, hazardous.
It is a dangerous sport. Best part about them, they only cost $10, which is super awesome. And because we love our studio audience so much, you're all going home with a pair of them. Lucky undies.
Yep.
Johnny, best of luck for the Melbourne Cup on Tuesday. How are you celebrating?
I'm going on a cruise ship to Melbourne. I have to do a show on Monday night in transit on the Melbourne Cup with a former wonderful jockey, Larry Olson, who won the Cup on Kenzie way back in 1987, now retired. And then on Cup Day, I'm not sure what I'll do yet. The Flemington crowd, despite the electricity and the atmosphere, can be a touch uncomfortable.
I reckon you'd hold your own, Johnny Tapp. Thank you for joining us this morning.
Pleasure.